Hi, John.
Oh, Butter. Oh, sweet pea. I love you.
My presentation today was primarily audio-visual, but the system's not working. I was going to show you the top 100 pictures I have of orbs. Since we don't have that, I need to describe each one individually and verbalize it. No, I appreciate Andrea. That was an amazing introduction. Thank you so much. And a round of applause again for Andrea doing what she's been doing for quite some time here in the field. I can tell you right now that is the next evolution. And there's things that I'd like to talk to you about in regards to this field that maybe you don't get a chance to see, whether it's television or films, in regards to this particular field of study. But Andrea is transitioning right now from what we would consider as paranormal investigators as a client or a victim. She's now, including last night, just begun her transition to be an investigator herself. And she's nervous as can be as she wants to communicate with the spirits. There's always that trepidation, especially after what happened in the house, that you don't know what you're communicating with. There's a term in this field that we've been using for quite some time, and this field pretty much is a quagmire footing. It's a very loose footing as far as what is foundation. We are always evolving. We are always changing as investigators. Now, I need to know by a show of hands, how many of you are part of or an individual involved in paranormal investigating? Show of hands. And how many of you are just fascinated by the field and are just here to learn more about it? So we're looking at about 90% of you who have done some sort of investigating. There are some events on the horizon and some events that are already in motion that are going to change the field very, very quickly. And as regards to the mindsets of those people such as John Zappas, David Roundtree, Thomas Fusco, people that we've had the opportunity to speak to on our shows. And the shows that we have are not about what's the scariest place you've ever been to, what's the most haunted place you've ever seen. This is about getting deep into the minds of the people in this field and asking the questions we need to ask. Primarily in this particular field right now, we're talking about what is it that we're communicating with. Now, if you talk in the aspect of theology, we're talking about everything that you speak to is a demon that is trying to coerce you to allowing them to come into your life. And to myself, after doing this over a decade and having the show for over 6 years, I can tell you that that is not even close to the truth. Are there things out there that are malevolent, that are trying to manipulate? Absolutely. But then there are people out there always trying to manipulate us as well. So when we get into this, a lot of the times we look at what is the collective consciousness, that we are all connected to each other, connected to the universe, not just our little blue dot in space, but to the universe. We've just forgotten. We've been polluted for millennia to not think about that. And now we're getting to a point in time where we're starting to explore it. You're now allowing your minds to reopen again. How many people who've been investigating since the most of you out there, 90% of you have been doing this, have gotten more in touch with their sixth sense since they started? Show of hands, please.
There you go.
When people are out there and investigating, they start to be able to communicate and pick things up, myself included. I have never, never been to the farmhouse in Harrisville, Rhode Island, where Andrea grew up. She has never shown me pictures of the inside, yet I've been able to tell her where the Christmas tree was set in the house during the holidays, where the stereo was set, a rug on the second floor, the lampshade up on the second floor in the bathroom, the carving of Mr. Richardson's name in the basement. And I'm not a psychic. I'm not a psychic. Though I will, if you want to pay me, I'll give you a reading. I don't know what I'll give you the lottery numbers even. But I will tell you that there is something to that collective consciousness. And this is where the experiments are starting. We're starting to look at redundancies in our communication. So we're looking for repetitive. People who have seen the show see somebody using an obelisk. And the obelisk is basically this device that sounds like Stephen Hawking's upstairs knife. And as you're going through that, people go, and let's put them, okay, so there's a story here. Upstairs, somebody was stabbed. But no one's ever said, can you say upstairs again if you can manipulate this? Can you repeat it multiple times? The redundancy is key to understand that we are making connections with an intelligent spirit and not just an EMF field that's come through and manipulated it. Spirit box is something I've been using on a regular basis recently with some amazing results with Andrew doing sessions to communicate with Bathsheba Sherman, with Mrs. Arnold, and some of the other spirits residing in the farmhouse and who have followed her as well, and Prudence, which John Zaffis had a chance to listen to one of these sessions and heard Prudence's name on a multitude of occasions. There is something to the redundancy and using the communication and reinforcing it over and over again. Now, I don't want to bore you with the technical details to this, but I do want to say that's where this whole aspect of Andrea and I creating this show came into play. We talked about it for 2 days, 3 days, and said, let's do this. And what transpired out of that was a great communication between two people who, for whatever reason, synergy was there. Whether this was a predestined or preordained scenario that we were supposed to go through this entire thing, that it was designed years ago, but it came to pass that immediately after we met each other, we were going to go on this journey. And the journey has been incredible, talking to some of the greatest minds in the field, talking about the most updated topics in this field. And as we continue on, and we invite you all to join us as well, and again, it's A World Awakening on Facebook, or finding Andrea on Facebook, and you can find we're all, just like on the internet, interlinked. The collective consciousness is the same way. And we want to share that with you, but we also want to be able to have you guys understand from the get-go that you are all already connected, as we all are in this room. Now, Andrea, I have anything to add to that before we go to a Q&A?
I think that the most important thing to add to that is that anybody who's heard me speak understands that I have some key phrases that I use because they are catalysts to discussion. And one of them is thoughts are things. Make no mistake about it. Before something manifests in reality, it begins in mind. And so the reason that George and I have embarked on this incredible spiritual journey together is because what we do on Tuesday nights is we throw pebbles into the pond and then watch the concentric circles ripple out. And we don't care if we're talking to 20 people or we're talking to 2,000 people on any given Tuesday night. Minds are changing. Minds are evolving. If you are not, you know the old phrase, you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. I don't want to be a part of any problem. We are in critical need of changing the mindsets on this planet. There is already a sweeping wave of consciousness evolution occurring on this planet right now. A lot of you remember a couple of years ago, there was the Mayan calendar, and we were all supposed to just, you know, I guess gravity was going to shift the poles and we were all going to float into space. Well, gee, that didn't happen. But you know what? I will tell you, I've done the research. The Mayans were absolutely right. They chronicled the end to the end of the Piscean Age. We are now truly in the age of Aquarius. And as we make that transition, what is occurring is that we are becoming more fluid in our perceptions. We are becoming more open in our perceptions. And I'll tell you what, the five senses, the three-dimensional five senses that we use to relegate ourselves to this safe place, it's a lie. We are so much more than that. We are so much. We come into this world knowing that we are immortal souls. And what happens when little kids go up to mommy or daddy in the morning and say, Grandma came and read me a bedtime story last night. And mommy says, oh no, honey, that was just a dream. Grandma died before you were born. Chances are really good that Grandma came and read that child a story that night and made contact with that child. And so what mommy has done or daddy has done, because they are now adults and have had their sense of immortality conditioned out of them, they continue that cycle and start to condition out of their own children magical thinking, you know, or it was a nightmare, it was an encounter. And when we evolve to the place where we understand that we are integrally connected with spirit all the time, when we all get to that place, the evolution will take that next quantum leap. So what I say to you is talk about this with your friends. Talk about expanding out. You know, the universe is an ever-expanding, burgeoning, multi-dimensional place. We're in it. So logically, 1 + 1 = 2. And we are part of the collective consciousness. We are part of the whole. We are an absolutely essential part of the whole. When we start to accept that, we in turn expand like the universe, bring others into our circle. You know, my father said to me yesterday, we were standing on the battlefield in Gettysburg, which was a profoundly moving experience for me.
Memorable.
Absolutely beautiful.
Yes.
But, you know, my father and I were having a discussion, and he said, you know, I looked around and I said, how many, 650,000 people died in the Civil War. To what end? For what purpose? And what have we learned that we are still waging war all over this planet? And he said to me, it will never stop. And I said, if I believed that, Dad, I'd fold my cards right now. Because, you know, I understand his point of view. He's lived longer than I have. He's seen more than I have. However, if I believed truly in my soul that we could not overcome our feelings of necessity to war with each other, if I felt that we could not live peacefully as a global community, and if I had to relinquish that hope, I wouldn't want to be here anymore. I just wouldn't. So I will continue to go on my journey, and my journey is very simple. It is my job to spread the word, the good word of light and love.
Absolutely, absolutely. We want to take that 15 minutes here to open it up for anybody who would like to ask Andrea any questions.
Or you.
Or me, if you
want. Ask George a question first, please.
No, perfectly fine. Go ahead.
Yes, honey.
Why were you chosen to have this experience?
If I could answer that, I don't know, but I do feel chosen. You used the right word. My mother said to me a couple of years ago, she said, you know, I think that we were destined to be at the farm, and I think that you were the one that was chosen to tell this story. And I agree with that. I think that that's absolutely true, but I don't know why. And you know what? I think there are some questions that aren't supposed to be answered in this realm. Maybe it's the surprise when we make that transition, but I think that what's really important is that I fulfill my mission, and with the help of George, who has been incredibly helpful to me in terms of getting the word out in every conceivable venue, and because we are so like-minded, what we share is this compulsion to spread the news, because it's our job. It's almost like we were assigned to do this, as I felt that we were assigned to the house. And I will tell you one thing that you might not know if you haven't read the books yet. I will tell you that my epiphany experience at the farm, there was nothing violent about it. There was nothing negative about it. My mom got up one night at about 11 o'clock at night. And I'm sorry, that's her epiphany. My epiphany was this. I came home from college to celebrate my 18th birthday. Dad thankfully flew me home, and I was so cold. You know supernatural cold. You know the difference between cold and supernatural cold. Well, I walked into that house, and I was supernaturally cold. I had missed my home so much, my family, my farm, my spirits. I had missed them so much. Mom put dinner out on the table. I wasn't hungry. I was cold. And I backed up to the fireplace and I put my hands behind me. I was wearing big, thick brown corduroys. And my last conscious thought was, oh, my God, I'm standing too close to the fire. Why don't I feel it? And then on my right side manifested a beautiful woman who my father saw from a distance. And he dropped his fork and hit the plate. Everybody else in the family who was already at the table turned and looked. And there they saw a side vision of a full body apparition who had come to welcome me home. I couldn't move my body, but I knew that I could turn my head. And I turned and I looked at her, and I saw a mirror reflection of my own image, and was absolutely mind blown, because this woman was me, as an old woman dressed in 17th century garb. And that was my moment of understanding. And I suddenly realized why we had been called back to the farm. And I'll tell you another thing. Mrs. Warren is completely against this, totally. But the instant that that farm goes up for sale again, I'm buying it back. And it is going to become a spiritual and supernatural center for research, exploration. I want to open that portal, cleverly disguised as a farmhouse, for everyone to come and experience. Johnny, John Zaffis has been there and has done, you should talk to him about his experiences there. Keith Johnson has been, he's not here this week, but you know, Facebook him and he'll tell you his experiences there. There have been a lot of people that have been in that house and understand the power of the place. And so yes, I was chosen, and I believe that my connection with that place is familial. But I'll tell you another thing. The reason I wrote these books, I don't want to go back to the farm in another life. I don't. I want to ascend this time. And the only way for me to do that, in terms of my logical mind, is to tell their story and tell it well. That's all they ever wanted in the first place, was to be acknowledged.
I want to address that question also in saying that we've all been chosen.
That's right. Everybody in this room has, or you wouldn't be here.
If you have already stepped past that aspect of people saying, what are you doing sitting in the dark at night with a recorder on a cold slab piece of concrete for 3 hours going, can you tell me your name? Why are you here? When did you die? And you've persevered, and you've endeavored, and you've grown, and you have developed your own styles and your own techniques, and consistently change, because the minute you stagnate, you become one of the zombies, those people who are in those cubicles every day and just look at that piece of paper, that computer screen, and their eyes are bloodshot, and they don't look at the bigger picture. Constantly evolve, get excited about some new type of equipment or techniques, find new people to investigate with. We've got people in the field who run around naked doing an investigation. Wouldn't recommend it if it's got cameras. But try different things. We have an investigation opportunity that we're going to be doing here soon, where I'm bringing on board, because there's children involved with it, the game Operation. Remember the game?
Yeah.
And we're setting it up so that the little connector, the clip is close enough to the wires or where the funny bone would be or any other spot, that if it's just slightly pressed, it'll light up. Be inventive and try different things. If you're going to do this and you're already an oddball out, but you've been chosen millennia ago to do this, long before your existence, whether you want to talk about DNA memory, genetic memory, preordained, predestined, you were here for a reason, and it's only just begun. Questions other for Andrew? More questions? Yes.
Grandmom reading the story to the child, and that brought me to, I'm always very interested in both of your opinions, actually. What do you think about dreaming about spirit? I find myself sometimes very involved with my loved ones that have passed, and I can tell you, I wake up in the morning and I feel like I've been somewhere. I actually have, I've actually had like sore ribs, and I've had a bruise on my leg. And I've been doing something fun with my dad and fell. Or, you know, I'm just wondering, like, what is your opinion as far as that goes?
I think, I'll speak first to this. I think that when you're dreaming, you're already in the ethereal realm. You know, I dream in Technicolor. I always have. I mean, long, drawn out dreams that just seem to go on forever. And I travel. I go to different places. Sometimes I go to different planets. I don't know where I go all the time. But I will tell you that when you are asleep, when that part of your mind is shut down and you open up the part that we don't use most of the time, that's an easy entrance for spirit. Because they've got you where they want you. They can communicate without distraction to you. And a case in point is I had a dog years ago that I was madly in love with, and he died an inexplicable death, and I was devastated by his loss. Widget was his name. And about a week after I had sustained this enormous loss that I thought I would never recover from. I had a dream, and my grandmother, my father's mother, had Widget sitting in her lap, and I was able to understand that he too had made his transition, and she was taking care of him until I get where I'm going. And I'm just really, really hoping that there's a massive farm somewhere for me where all of the animals that I've ever loved and have rescued will be waiting for me, because I truly believe that there is, we are part of the collective soul. And animals have it, all creatures have it. If you look into an animal's eyes and you see that point of intelligence, you know we share that, or we wouldn't be able to communicate with them at all. So in that particular case, that was a very comforting dream for me. But you know what? When you go to bed at night, if you want to visit with someone, tell them before you go to sleep. And as soon as you go into that state, it opens that door. And it's a very loving, very interactive experience. Speak to it.
I dream of pizza. I just dream of pizza.
Slimy.
It's a shame to constantly put him on the spot, but I would consider him a mentor. John Zaffis, I've known him for many, many years, and we've had a lot of discussions on multiple topics of this field and outside of this field also. He's an amazing chef. He loves movies like I do, so we've had great topics of discussion in the past. But something of recent, which is very disconcerting for me, having been privileged enough over the last decade to have been to the Stanley Hotel in Estes Park, Colorado on three occasions, Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum on three occasions, Rolling Hills Asylum, Eastern State Penitentiary, Waverly Hills, Bobby Mackey's, Myrtle's Plantation, the Haughton Mansion, the list goes on. And I've been fortunate enough to know that every single one of these places I've been to, I have never had an encounter, so to speak, of malevolent level, where people say they've been picked up, thrown, scratched, beaten, attacked, dated. I don't know. I mean, everybody's got a story of something happening with spirits. Never had anything. And I think it's because also I'm very grounded, spiritually grounded. The last time I went to church was 9/11. But I speak to God every day, and I know He's with me and within me. And I don't want to wax on religiously, but I know that when I'm in the place, I'm protected. About a year and a half ago, and there's a location in Florida where I live that we do our training, and something has just kind of festered over the last year and a half. We don't know what it is and how it happened. Other teams may be coming and doing things they shouldn't be doing, whatever it happened. All of a sudden, I had four dreams, and I'll make this very, very brief, over the span of a year and a half, which doesn't seem like much, but the storyline behind them was so horrific. First one was just a feeling in the dream, it was a hotel, of a ominous or malevolent creature trying to drag me down. Second one was just the eyes. But that was a feeling of euphoria. I felt empowered that if there was something that negative out there, that there was something as good, if not greater, to combat it with. Third one, I don't want to, I could talk to you guys individually about it. I want to do it out here completely because it still gets me a little bit emotional, but in regards to family, and it was the hands of a demon and the face and the name. The last one was on Christmas Eve, visiting family in their house. And these are all dreams, mind you. Or as John put it, spiritual terrorism. On this fourth one, it was full manifestation. I don't want a fifth, because each one has advanced. Now, has anything happened in my, as I call it, my house of Zen, my parents' house, anywhere as far as manifestation in life? No, I've not had anything. But when you're in your subconscious state, you're more vulnerable to suggestion. You're not able to protect. But on those last two severe ones, I woke up, one saying, in the name of Jesus Christ, I cast you out. From a subconscious state, I woke up saying it. To the second time that it happened down in my folks' house at Christmas time, where I woke up saying the Lord's Prayer. Just an instinctive thing. So I know that I'm protected, but it was so impactful that I called that man and I said, I need to know where I stand. And he was so helpful and so comforting. And I'm completely grounded about it. If it happens again, whatever happens, the thing about it that's wonderful and goes back to the collective consciousness, and I need you guys to understand this, you're never on your own.
Ever.
Never on your own. That there's somebody out there, whether it's a gentleman of John Zaffis' status to anybody else in the community, but you'll always have a support team. That's what I love about this field. Is there drama? Oh, yes. God, yes,
little
there's drama in this field.
Just a smidge, right?
But that's
a smidge of drama in the field?
That's people.
Yeah.
That's right. And that's what it's all about.
It is.
I hope that helps answer your question, though. I hope it does.
It did. Just acknowledging it was great.
Thank you.
I do have a question. My background is more with... I did a lot of bereavement counseling, so I, you know, the whole paranormal and the ghosts and that was kind of like her thing, and she just kind of brought me along. But I have a tremendous amount of background with the afterlife,
yes.
being with people who've had near-death experiences, the whole nine yards, spanning back 20 years. So my question is, why do you think that, because I do believe as well there's always someone with us, whether you call them angels, guides, whatever. Why do you think that when they're there and these people are passing and these spirits, why aren't they taking them? Why aren't they bringing them with them into the light? And why are they still here?
Free will. It's their choice on that. No matter how they could be coaxed or explained that this is your next destination, and there's that always, oh God, remember that time that I was, and I stole that candy bar, and am I going to go to hell for that? I don't know. Earthbound spirits, you don't, and then it gives, it's also that feeling of, if I leave, will I be able to come back and see my friends or my family? And this is all speculation, because we still don't know.
Right, well that's just, I mean, like I said, I've had...
But free will, whether you talk to anybody in the clergy in this field, and most investigators, but it's all based on free will. You can't be possessed without free will. You could be oppressed to the point that you give up. You're giving up your will. That's the concern to it, but free will. It's always been the key for me.
And that's Andrea? Why I address, I do agree. Several of the spirits that manifested in the farmhouse, as my mother did the historical research, determined that several of these spirits had either committed suicide or they had died inexplicable deaths. They had died so suddenly or tragically that they didn't seem to know they were dead. So spirits themselves fall into different categories. But my hypothesis about this, and keep in mind, now these were individuals that lived in the 1700s and 1800s, respectively. They were absolutely indoctrinated to believe through their religion at the time, and persists to this day, that if you claim your own life, you will burn in hell. It's not your decision to make. You might own the vessel, but you don't get to decide when the vessel no longer sustains your soul. And I think what happens often, and many times many of you being investigators have probably encountered this as well, that the spirits that manifest have an issue. And I think that the issue that they have is fear. I think they're afraid to go to the light because they were told that they will be rejected. And so it is safer to remain an earthbound spirit. So I would like to, after this event is over and George and I are back at our table, and please, any of you, feel free to come and talk with us about any of the hypotheses and theorems that we have put out into the world and what your theories are. Because you know what? We're not the authorities. We're not. We're just messengers. I'm not a sage. She's not an oracle. We are messengers. And all of us are messengers. And we all have a purpose to serve. So let's interact and talk about these issues and these things. And give us your feedback as well. Because you could say something so brilliant that we surreptitiously steal it and use it on next Tuesday night show. Okay? Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes?
So I'm sure a lot of other people are wondering.
The producers thought that if they told the whole true story of what happened in our house, it would run people out of the news. And this is how James Bond put it to me personally. James came up to me when our family went out to the set, and he said, I can't make a movie that is based on a true story that is literally unbelievable. People are going to expect some element of, and that's when Chad and Carrie Hayes, the screenwriters, also came to me very apologetically and said, oh, then, you know, there might be, change some things, really? But I'll tell you, they've toned it so far down. They found the story itself. I'd given them volume one and volume two. They had it at their disposal. So, and I had given them a lot of information from volume three, including in a complete timeline of events. There isn't a single scene in the movie that's extracted directly from the books because they were afraid. Here we go. Let's revisit this theme. They were afraid to tell the truth. Because the truth in this case is literally stranger than fiction. But I will tell you that there are little kisses from God in the film. The things that told me it was okay that they did what they did. One of them was the wind chimes that Cindy goes running through the house with. We had a set identical, huh, Dad? We had an identical set that were hanging on our front porch. The white cat in Shanley Caswell, who plays Ming, there's a picture of a folk art cat on the mantelboard in her bedroom. I have that in my room. In fact, George posted it on Facebook when he was at our house the other night. So you can go on my page and see it. Scroll down a little bit. They didn't know that. Julie Berghoff, who did all the set design, she had no idea. She'd never seen any inside photographs of the house when she did the design of this other house that they used. There are 2,600 different colonial prints of paper out there to use. She chose the one that was in our house. And it goes on and on and on. Things that they could not conceivably know about, and yet they appeared in the film. And so that tells me it's okay. It's okay. But I will tell you, and, you know, don't share this, just secret between us. There will be a real telling of this story. Watch and wait. It's coming.
Isn't it funny how the story of the Perron family, a case from Ed and Lorraine Warren, has taken on its own identity from the movie and the books, that even more so if you've seen Monsters University, there's a little spoof of them coming down the stairs and the door opens. The Haunted House 2, the Wayans movie, the comedy that's coming out, is based upon The Conjuring. It just perpetuates the story. It perpetuates the interest in the field, even from a tongue-in-cheek aspect of the films. But it makes people say, I would like to research and look into this. And it is an amazing, amazing story. There was somebody who had a question in the front row here. Yes, ma'am.
Well, this is a little tidbit. I had one cat for 14 years. Her name was Cuddles, all black and white. And when I moved, she was still there with me all this time. She was my roommate for a while. And she passed away in about maybe 4 or 5 years ago, probably closer to five. So I'd gotten two other cats. And I was in my bedroom, and my girls were up there on the bed with me. And I had my door cracked about like that. And I was wide awake watching TV. And I see this cat walk by, and I'm like, there's my cuddle girl. There she is. And it just kind of freaked me out.
For those of you in the back, just real quick, she's talking about an animal apparition of a family pet that she could see again after they had passed. Go ahead.
Embrace it and celebrate it. I told you, she'll never leave you. She's there all the time. Whether or not you see her or not, her attachment to you was so profound in terms of love. She can't bear to leave you. She's just waiting until you go.
Right outside my window.
Yeah.
She's buried right outside my floor every night. You know, if I had the window up, close it down, whatever, I'll say, good night, Coco.
You know what I'm glad about? I'm glad that I don't have to feed all the animals that I, you know? I'm glad that I'm down to like a dozen living animals and that I don't have to feed, house, vet care, all the ones that have passed on and are still hanging around. One of the things that happened at the farm is that when we moved there, our dog absolutely would not cross the threshold. That was true in the movie. That was true. But do you know something? This is, you know, I heard you thinking. The thing that was so extraordinary and one of the most emotional moments in the film for me was when Sadie died, because that actually happened and I didn't put it in the books. It was too raw. All these years later, so painful that we lost our dog in a bizarre, inexplicable way. He ran up to the school bus to greet us coming home. and slipped on a piece of ice and fell underneath the back wheel of the school bus as it left. And he died in my arms. And I said, Mom, I'm not putting it in the book. I'm not. I don't even want to go there. And yet, there it was in the film. You know what? I'll tell you what. There's more to this than meets the eye. Use the third one. I think we're out of time. However, you know, we have parting gifts. You can talk to us at the door as we go. Big hugs and kisses for anybody that wants them. Meet us over at our table. Any questions that you have? And we thank you all very much for joining us.
Yes, today. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Les just gave you the signal.
Yeah. So many different emotions.